it comes from you.
All of my help comes from you. Hey! Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever time it is that you are joining us on today. We would love to welcome you for joining us at our virtual worship experience at St. Luke, the House of Healing in Grand Rapids, Michigan. We know that you're sitting at home, but that's not going to stop you from worshiping God, right? No, I thought not. So, since it's not going to stop us from getting our worship and praise on, I'm going to stop talking so that you guys can join me in service. All right? I'll see you inside service.
Oh, come, let us worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let's give him all the glory, honor, and praise, for the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him.
Thank you. Spirit of the Lord is. There is one true church, both apostolic and universal, by whose most holy faith we do reverently and sincerely declare, boldly affirming what it is we believe by the use of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Our scripture lesson comes from the book of Galatians. Galatians chapter 6, verses 6 through 10, and I'll be reading from the King James Version. And it reads on this wise: Let him that is taught in the word communicate unto him that teacheth in all good things. Be not deceived, God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap, if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let us pray. Eternal, all-wise, and everlasting God, Lord, we just thank you for this day. Thank you for our uprising, Lord Jesus. Thank you for allowing us to have a reasonable amount of health and strength, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness, for your mercy, for your grace, for your power, for your healing, for your deliverance, Lord. We just want to say thank you. If we had 1,000 tongues, we could not thank you enough. Lord, we come to you now asking that you would look upon those who found it necessary to defame our nation's capital. Lord, we ask that you would get down into their hearts and their souls and in their minds, Lord, and that you would remove the hatred, Lord, and all that caused them to do those domestic terrorist acts. Lord, we ask that you would heal them, and that even in the process, that they would find you. Lord, turn also the searchlight of heaven on our souls, Lord, that we may be able to appropriately navigate and process this, Lord, through your lens, Lord, through how you would have us to process this, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you for allowing us to be able to share throughout, Lord, globally and also within our community, Lord, with our church family and abroad, your word, your scripture, your song, prayer, Lord Jesus. We are leaning and depending on you, Lord, to continue to heal, deliver, and set free. Lord, we thank you for our manservant, the Reverend Dwight L. Gutridge, Lord. We thank you for allowing him to be able to bring the word of God to your people. We hope that something will be said that would allow one to have a closer walk with you. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity again. We ask that you would continue to allow us to be the light for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen.
Behold the Lamb of God.
Behold.
blessing us and reminding us that in all things we ought to behold the Lamb of God. It's preaching time now, family. And I want you to share with me in the book of Galatians chapter 6, the book of Galatians chapter 6, starting at about verse 7. It says this: Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. I want you to think with me for a couple of moments from the thought, the chickens have come home to roost. The chickens have come home to roost. Let's have a word of prayer. Speak now, Lord, for your servant heareth. Speak now, Lord, for your people certainly need a word from you. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be found acceptable unto you, God, for you are my strength, redeemer, and my rock. God, allow me to preach not a word that sounds good, but under your Holy Spirit, allow me to preach a word that will do some good. And to the name of your Son, Jesus, I pray. Amen. The chickens have come home to roost. By way of introduction, family, you know, I know, and we know that I borrow my sermon title from a proverbial saying that was made famous by the slain civil rights leader, Minister Malcolm X, when he declared after the assassination of one President John F. Kennedy in Dallas, Texas, that the chickens have come home to roost. Malcolm X was suggesting in this statement, encapsulating the events of the day, that the seeds of systemic racism and hatred that was being perpetually sown in the United States had brought forth a harvest of hate that led to the assassination of President Kennedy. Malcolm was sagaciously suggesting that the bad that this country has been perpetrating, all the acts of evil that have been done to others in the name of patriotism, the oppression that has been laid on the backs of others, and the marginalization that others have been mistreated with, has finally come back with a vengeance. This saying of the chickens coming home to roost is really a polite way of saying to others that you reap what you sow. It's a polished way of saying that the wickedness that you do to others will come one day home and land on you. It's a pretty way of saying that you keep on messing with folks, don't be surprised when they mess back with you. May I suggest to someone who is tuned in for a word of God or from God today, especially after all that we witnessed this week, that no proverbial saying is more appropriate right now than the chickens have come home to roost. Some of you are looking at your screens and wondering, what am I talking about? Well, let me help you help me. For more years than we care to admit, we have witnessed in this country moments where those who are disheartened, disinherited, and disenfranchised are treated as if they do not matter.
That's right.
Often those folk look like me and others. In the last between the haves and the have-nots. We have heard our president call countries that we come from assholes. We have heard it proclaimed over and over again that America was going to be great again. Yeah. Meaning that we are going back to the good old days when folks knew their places. When white people enjoyed privileges that others didn't have access to or were relegated to poverty. We're going back to Jim Crow. We're going back to white only and black only water fountains. We have watched. And some evangelical faith leaders have excused ungodly, unethical, and unrepentant behavior by the leader of this free world. Divisive rhetoric has been spoken over and over again. Uh-huh. Racism and hate have been openly sanctioned. It's open season on black men and black women by the police. Certain groups have been told openly that it's okay to attack others who do not look like you. This president has suggested that it's all right to take aggressive action when you don't agree with what has happened. And it's okay to operate in your privilege to provoke or push a change to happen. Uh-huh. Here's the problem with all of that. When it is sown from a place of hate, when it is sown from a place of darkness and wickedness, what you will eventually end up with is a harvest of earth and a heritage of hate, and the chickens will come home to roost. You saw it. You saw what happened this week. The capital of the United States of America was overran by supporters of this current president for 9 more days, if they don't get him first. Who told an already agitated crowd of thousands of people that the election was stolen from him. This president blatantly and deliberately sowed a seed of discord, dissension, and discontent, and he dared this crowd to go to the Capitol and take action because of their dissatisfaction of the results of the election that he clearly lost. And then he double dog dared them to get wild when they went there.
Yes, he did.
Hear me, family. The seed that the president sowed throughout his presidency finally produced a harvest that will be felt for many years to come. In other words, family, on Wednesday, January 6th, when thousands of inflamed followers of a seditious president stormed the Capitol, the chickens came home to roost. May I quickly suggest to you today, before you say that I'm not preaching the Bible, that the Word of God warns us about the possibility of this very thing happening? Do you mind if I cut across the field to our biblical text on today? Paul writes to the church at Galatia to address the systemic issues that was separating the church just as this country is separated. The church at Galatia, watch this, y'all, argued that those Gentiles who were converted to Christianity had to assimilate or become like the Jewish Christian. Hear what I'm about to give you. They said, in order for you to be accepted, you got to be like us. They were told that they had to practice the same customs that the Jewish people practiced. They were told that they had to be circumcised as Jewish men were circumcised. Paul has a harsh rebuke for them. He even suggests that they've been bewitched by someone. This letter written to the church of Galatia reminds us of our new identity in Christ. It reminds he encourages those who say they love Christ to live in the unity of Christ. When Paul gets to chapter 5, he is addressing some of the issues that are prevalent in the church and in the world that's caused by pride. Paul gives a general but practical application to the Galatian church. He says, let's not become conceited, provoking, and envious of each other. Too much pride can adversely affect and attack the body like a cancer, and that cancer called pride would soon consume the body. Can I say it differently? Too much pride would affect someone's mind so much so that they cannot believe that they lost an election. Too much pride will affect the followers of that one who is affected by pride so that they will believe that whatever he says is the truth. Paul said, we must crucify the pride of our sinful nature and be led by the Spirit of God, who alone has the power to overthrow the dictatorship of pride. The pride of position, privilege, and power held by the 1%ers in this country has deteriorated any progress that is being made like a cancer. Stop saying, baby, we've come a long way. We've not come that long of a way. When Paul gets to chapter 6, he wants his reading audience to know that God's people have a responsibility of sowing seeds that will bring forth a healthy, holistic harvest of good. But what is being sown was something entirely different. Do you mind if I preach the way I feel it? Do you mind if I preach the way the Lord gave it to me? Paul says to the church that we have a responsibility to sow and do good to all men. We have a responsibility to encourage and lift all of humanity. That means everybody. No matter who they are, no matter what they have or don't have, no matter the color of their skin, no matter their political party, no matter what their ideology might be, we're to lift up every man. And may I suggest that the seed that has been planted in this country since its inception has only been for the benefit of a few and not for all. When only a few benefit from the tree, from the fruit of the tree of life, we ought not be surprised when there are protests and marches like Black Lives Matter movement that demand that we be given the fruit of life. When there are systemic barriers, some that allow certain groups of people to create generational wealth, and another group is relegated to a caste system of generational poverty, do not be surprised when those same oppressed people riot and loot places that they cannot ever hope to go in and shop. I'm not saying it's right, but I understand. When we see one group of people gather who are heavily policed because of the melanin in their skin, and then we see another group of people gather with less melanin, I might add, without police presence, who then take over the Capitol, do not be surprised when the group who were heavily policed eventually are forced to cry out for equal treatment for all. What I'm suggesting, or what I'm trying to suggest to you, beloved, is when the chickens come home to roost, it's because of the seed that has been sown. When the chickens come home to roost, it's because one group realizes that they're not as valued y'all, that determines the quality of the harvest. It's because the seed that has been sown is not always a good seed. Can I argue that that's what this text is taking to teach us? And I'm done.
Yes.
Paul pushes 3 points about the seed.
Okay.
Paul first says that there's detriment. There is detriment in a selfish seed. There is detriment in a selfish seed.
Right.
Watch this, family. Paul says, for the thought in his flesh shall reap corruption. The thought in his flesh shall reap corruption. The thought of a bad seed will reap the corruption of a bad harvest. In other words, the seed sown out of weak wickedness will reap corruption. Come here. Let me prove it to you. On Wednesday, the commander-in-chief, out of his flesh, dared those who were in attendance to go wild in their response to the affirmation hearing.
Uh-huh.
Hear what I'm telling you. The president planted a wicked seed that was violent, vulgar, and vindictive, and the harvest of the seed was divisive, disastrous, and destructive.
Uh-huh.
It was an attack on the Capitol, not seen in more than 100 years. Many declared that they were surprised at what happened. Can I tell you something? You're not judging me, family.
Yeah.
I was not surprised, nor was I shocked.
Okay.
Can I tell you why?
Why?
We got what was planted.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Anybody that's a gardener understands what I'm talking about. If you plant an apple seed, you are not surprised when you get apples off the tree. When you plant tomatoes, you are not surprised when you get tomatoes on your vine. Well, when you sow seeds of discord, you should not be surprised when you reap a harvest of discord and destruction. Paul understood that what we put or sow into the atmosphere or into the ground would come back and reap more damage in his harvest than good. And I wonder if I have a witness who's watching who will be honest or transparent enough to admit that there have been seasons that you have sown some bad seeds and it resulted in a harvest of disappointment, a harvest of detriment in your life, a harvest of depression. I now understand what Mama meant when she used to tell me, if you ain't got nothing nice to say so, then keep your mouth closed.
Uh-huh.
You have a witness that sometimes it seems it's better not to say anything at all, because the seed you are planting may be a seed that will produce a harvest of hurt, not only for someone else, but on you as well. What happened this week was not only detrimental to those who were in the building, it was detrimental to the entire country who had to watch this wickedness that was sown by one who carelessly and callously stirred up a crowd that was looking for a reason to react recklessly. And can I encourage you, my father's children? Can I encourage you, my mature saints? Can I encourage some of my people to watch the seeds that we plant that might cause others to be hurt or try to go and hurt someone else? Watch the seeds that will cause someone to be broken or seek out to break someone themselves. Again, family, Paul warns us about the detriment of a selfish seed. You can't plant a selfish seed
But then he tells us, after he talks about the detriment of a selfish seed, he tells us about the delight of a spiritual seed. The delight of a spiritual seed. I'm glad today, family, that Paul reminds us that there is an alternative to sowing seeds in our flesh. He tells us that we can also sow spiritual seeds. Do you see it? He says in the B part of the same verse, he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. That just made me happy. And I tell you why. Because Paul is suggesting that there are seeds that we can sow that will have eternal consequences. Hear me. Farmers also understand that there are some good seeds that when planted, these seeds will continue to produce a good harvest year after year because of the type of seed that it was. That's why roses come back every season, no matter what the winter season looked like, because it's a good seed. But likewise, if we sow spiritual seed in the right ground, they will continue to bring forth a harvest of blessing that will go on forever. I know I'm right about it because there were seeds planted in this church by former pastors that are still bringing forth good crops right now. And I do not mind telling you that. I'm enjoying the fruit of the seed planted a long time ago. So may I encourage you to plant spiritual seeds that will bless those who come behind you. Plant seeds that will bless your children. Plant seeds that will help someone who is down to be lifted up years later. Plant a seed that will encourage someone who you may never meet. Plant a seed that will have a positive, long-lasting effect on those who will come after you. Can I tell you why? Because what the president did this week, what he said, will have long-lasting negative consequences. The actions taken by this terrorist crowd, and they were terrorists, make no mistake about it, this week will have historical repercussions that will be a blemish on our history. The moments we witness this week will be recorded in the history book as one of our lowest moments, and this president's family name will always be attached to that negative moment. And I witness, I have a witness today who will declare that I will delight in sowing a spiritual seed because it pleases God. I will delight in blessing people because I don't want the chickens to come back and roost on me. I will intentionally sow a spiritual seed of love into the life of someone others have declared was unlovable. I will sow a seed of hope into the life of the one who are hopeless. I will sow a seed of compassion into the life of those who have been rejected by others. I heard somebody say that if I could help someone, Don't stop sowing good seed.
All right,
Paul says that we are not to grow weary in doing well.
Yes.
He says, because in due season, we shall reap if we faint not.
Yes.
Paul blesses me and encourages me after all the hell I saw on this week with this statement of assurance. Paul says, Dwight, don't get tired of sowing good seed. Don't become fatigued in doing good in the life of us. Because at the right time or in due season, we shall reap because we did not faint or give up. Preach, Dwight. How many of us have planted seeds of good and have waited for some good harvest to come, and it has still not happened for us yet. We're waiting on our yet moment. We're waiting on God to open the windows of heaven and begin to pour us out blessings. You are watching others who are planting seeds of hate, ascend into some of the highest offices in our land. You are watching those who are wicked to plant wicked seeds, and they are seemingly celebrated for their wickedness. Well, can I encourage you? As I encourage myself, my Bible says in the 37th Psalm, fret not thyself because of evil doers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like grass and wither as the green herbs. He then tells us to trust in the Lord and to do good. So shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Well, I need you to know that all you got to do is wait on the Lord and be of good courage. I need you to know that if you faint not, that in due season you will reap a harvest. You're wondering to yourself, preacher, what is due season? Well, due season is that special moment of time when God steps out of Kairos, God steps into Chronos, and God begins to give to us what we've been waiting for. Due season is when we shall receive that which is rightfully belonged to us. I heard somebody say that the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous. Well, I want you to know that due season means that if you can hold on, if you do not give up, if you do not quit, if you're not discouraged, due season is the moment that God allows us to see the harvest of the work we sow. A closely contested race. Abram lost. the state of Georgia, Lee expected her to go away with her tail tucked between her legs. Lee expected her to go away with her head bowed down. But instead of growing weary and lost, Abram started the organization that fought 2020 that began to fight against voter suppression. Abrams also began to sponsor voter registration rallies all over Georgia, teaching people about their right to vote. Stacey Abrams helped register an estimated 800,000 new voters. In 2019, Stacey Abrams lost her race, but she didn't let that stop her from sowing some good seed. Because in 2020, the chickens came home to root. She kept on fighting for the rights of others to vote. And the state of Georgia turned blue for the first time in 30 years. And we elected a new president and a new vice president, who I might add is a woman of color.
Yeah.
chickens. I declare, I decree that this is my season.
Family, we appreciate you allowing us to come into your homes one more time. Listen, thank God for your stewardship. Thank you for what you're doing so that we can continue to do ministry. You know, family, I gotta tell you, there are three ways that you can give to be a blessing to this church. The first way that you can give is through Givelify. Look us up. St. Luke and Amy Zion Church, we're in Grand Rapids, Michigan. We're the house of healing. St. Luke, Amy Zion Church, Grand Rapids, Michigan. The second way that you can give to be a blessing to us is through Cash App. Listen, our Cash App name is $SaintLukeAMEZ. $SaintLukeAMEZ. And finally, you can mail in your contribution. Our address is 101 Delaware Street Southeast, Grand Rapids, Michigan, 49507. Again, our address is 101 Delaware Street Southeast, Grand Rapids, Michigan, 49507. That's where the house of healing is, if you're looking for it. Family, thank you again for allowing me to come into your homes to proclaim this, the word of God. Family, what you sow is what you'll reap in a harvest. Will you pray with me this benedictive blessing, or receive this benedictive blessing? Now unto him that is able to keep you and I from falling, and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding great joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you. God keep you. We'll see you next week if God says the same.